Can you hear me? Like so many medical tests, have you ever wondered why this one had to be conducted on an empty stomach? They will talk. Abhi kya karein? Bombay hai bhai. They will talk. Let it be. So early in the morning, armed with a flask of tea and some sandwiches, we would set out for Breach Candy Hospital. What was it about hospitals that made M so calm? She was always civil to the doctors and nurses, and only once in a while the mania would flash out. In the depressive phase, she was terribly, horribly polite, often begging for forgiveness from total strangers and receiving puzzled benisons. But during the Lithosun period, she was always ready for a little chat. She would try to draw the other patients out, especially the quiet women in the waiting rooms. What's wrong with her? She would ask the husband if the wife could not be teased out of her cocoon of stubborn silence. Nerves, the husband would reply briefly. Come home and give her a hug, she would say. Take her to the pictures and hold her hand. Most of the time, the men would take these comments in their strides. Some would smile condescendingly. Some looked discomfited but said nothing. Those who suffer from mental illness and those who suffer from the mental illness of those they love grow accustomed to such invasions of their privacy. Does that make things easier for everyone? I'm still not sure. I used to wonder, what must it mean for a lower middle class woman to tell a stranger about her sexual history and her fantasy life? Does she understand the free association that is sometimes used, or why the psychiatric social worker wants to know so much about her childhood? By day, the Breach Candy Hospital catered to the affluent. In the early morning, the place was different. This was the time when a range of patients turned up, from those who needed their toxins monitored to young men taking a second physical examination. What are you waiting for? She once asked a morose young man who was thumbing through a thin file. I want to go to NDA, auntie. So why aren't you going? She asked him. They are saying I have albumin in my urine. Is that like egg white? I don't know, auntie, but they are not allowing. Have you prayed? Em asked. This seemed unnecessary because he was well anointed with sandalwood paste and turmeric, and there were a few grains of rice still sticking in the red iron oxide on his forehead. Yes, auntie, I have promised to write God's name 1 lakh times if I get into NDA. What is this NDA? The young man looked startled. Auntie, you don't know. It's National Defense Academy. Oh. Em was not sure that she approved, but she rallied. I will pray that you get to do what is right for you. What about you, auntie? Why you're here? I had a nervous breakdown and tried. I began to hiss a little at such promiscuous revelation. Don't mind my son, he's shy. I tried to kill myself, no? So I have to take pills and they have to examine my blood. You are mental, auntie? I bristled, but my mother didn't seem to mind. Yes, yes. Oh, good. My Buaji says God listens to the prayers of the mentals because they are touched by his hand. How nice. You hear that, Baba? I was touched by the hand of God and I have a hotline to him according to this young man, someone or the other. I will pray right now. Only the young man seemed to hesitate. He seemed to be assessing us. Then he took the plunge. Auntie, my Buaji is Muslim. And I am Christian and you are Hindu. So? Means he's wondering who you will pray to, M, I said to my mother. She looked at me, then she looked at him. I will pray to your Buaji's God. I will pray to Allah, she said. Did she? I would have prayed to any God at all, if I could have been handed a miracle, a whole mother, a complete family, and with it, the ability to turn and look away. Thank you. Clap like you mean it, I always say. Sorry.
Should I give you another long-winded compliment, Jenny? Okay, so this is about M. It's mainly her story. But as you have mentioned earlier, it was a large family saga when you started writing it. So how did you pare it down? Why did you choose to focus on this thing and what did you leave out?
You know, I think most families, if you examine them carefully, have a cast of characters that is magnificent. So there's an auntie who does conducts seances, and there's an uncle who ran away with a Portuguese princess and lived on a desert island. And these are stories that these are not my stories. These are stories that people have told me about their families. When I started writing this novel, I wanted to do that to my family. I wanted to collect all the characters that I'd been told about. There was a lovely man I met with my father on the Konkan Shakti when we were going to Goa, who was paranoid about the Portuguese. He was utterly sure that the Portuguese were following him because he had supported the Indians. So he had devised this thing why, when he died, his body would be hidden and another body would take its place. And that body would be buried in place of his body, and his body would be smuggled off. And it was completely unfathomable to anybody why either the Portuguese government or the Indian government would be worried about his dead body, since they were leaving his living body quite alone. But he was worried about it. So I had written this, you know, lovely passage in which this whole description of how he had changed his name and what his name was and whatnot. And when I was reading it after I started to do my final fecal detector reading, which is, you know, you abandon your book for a while, you abandon your writing for a while, you leave it so that you get some distance between yourself and it, and then you begin to read it as if it's someone else's. And then it begins to reveal itself to you. You can tell whether you've done a good job or you've just been faffing. You know, it helps me at any rate. I'm not saying it should be everyone's way of doing it, it's what I do. And I was reading all these passages and thinking, you just sound like such a prat, Geronimo. You sound like you're condescending to these people. You sound like you're making them into exotic little monkeys who are dancing. You haven't given them depth. You haven't given them nuance. You should give up writing as an endeavor. And in between, as I was reading these things and getting really depressed, because this was like the big shot I had given. I had chosen poverty, philosophy and prose as my boon companions for this time. I'd given up working. I was sitting at home largely in cotton shorts and nothing else and a smile, and working on this novel, writing it by hand, and it was not working. But what began to emerge from the detritus of this 5-year period when I was working on this novel was these four people, the Mendes family, their attempt to deal with the mental illness of the mother, the ways in which they created an almost hermetic environment in which they were sealed together, working out this destiny of love and vulnerability. And that seemed to me to have something that I would look for in other people's writing. I don't know how to say this, but it was what I felt I could put my name to without horror or shame. And so I began to sift those passages out of the book. And at the end of reading some 7.5 lakh words, 750,000 words, I found that I had about 12,000 usable words. So I then thought, this is a novella. It's a nice short novella. I'll build it a little and I'll use it as a novella. But karte karte, when I started rewriting it, bits began to add. I had to explain things. I had to open out passages. And I found that it was possible to think of it as a novel rather than a long short story. And finally it became a novel. So, you know, we were talking about how killing your babies and actually, you know, like squashing bits.